Hello friends, welcome to my channel. In last videos, we have studied about self-pollination and cross-pollination. What are the contrivances which are required to attain the self-pollination and cross-pollination? In today's video, we are going to discuss about the agents of pollination. So if we observe the self-pollination, so the most important criteria to achieve the self-pollination is that the flower must be bisexual. That's why in self-pollination there is no need of any agents for the pollination. But when we observe the cross-pollination, so at that time the plants will need different types of agents to carry out the pollen grains from one place to another place, and that agents today we are going to discuss in detail. So see that the agents which are required for the pollination, they are going to categorize into two types, that is abiotic agents and biotic agents. Abiotic agent means those agents or those agents which are required for the process of pollination, if they are non-living one, just like the water and wind, they are categorized under the abiotic types of agents. While the biotic agent means those living agents which can participate in the process of pollination by transfer the pollen grains from one place to another place, like birds, insects, ants, snails, snakes, bats. So all of them, they are categorized under the biotic agents. So just see that under the abiotic agents, there are two types of agents, like wind pollination and the water pollination. Under the biotic agencies, the biotic agencies, they are categorized under insect pollination, bird pollination, bat pollination, snails pollination, and the pollination with the help of ants. So one by one we are going to discuss about the each agency and what are the characteristic features which are required for the plants to carry out the pollination by using that type of agencies. So let's we see first about the abiotic type of agencies, and under that one first we see the wind pollination. So see that the pollination which takes place with the help of wind, that we called it as an anemophily. Then we see what are the most important conditions that are required for the plants or for the pollen grains to carry out the anemophily. So if you observe this one, see that your pollen grains, it should be spiny one. Then the pollen grains should show the presence of wings, they show presence of small hair like structure. Or the stigma to carry out the anemophily, it should be hairy one. Then just see that to carry out the anemophily or with the pollination which can take place with the help of wind. So for that one, the anthers, they should be exerted. Okay. As well as they show presence of versatile nature. That's why whenever the wind can blow, the anthers can easily blow along with that wind. So these are the main characteristic features to carry out the wind pollination. So just see here, the anthers, they are very hairy one. See here how the pollination can take place, how there is a transfer of pollen grains from one place to another place with the help of wind. So these are some characteristic conditions that we require. So just see that to carry out the wind pollination, the flower must be small. There is no need of large flower. Then pollen grain should be produced in large quantity. See that during the wind pollination, there is a huge wastage of pollen grains. That's why the pollen grain, they should be produced in large quantity. See here, for wind pollination, there is no need to become the flower attractive, or it should have the particular type of fragrance. That's why the flowers or plants, they doesn't have to waste their energy to become the flower more attractive or fragrant one. Then there is also, there is no any need to produce the nectar, because it is the pollination which can take place with the help of wind. Okay, so these are some conditions which are required to carry out the wind pollination. Then see that there are some example of anemophilous plants which can carry out the wind pollination, like basically the Poaceae family members, which shows presence of exerted and versatile anthers, like maize, wheat, members of pinus, papaya, mulberry. So all of them, they show presence of wind pollination. So next we see about the next abiotic agency, that is the water. So the pollination which can take place with the help of water, that we call it as an hydrophily. And see that this hydrophily, it is going to categorized under two types, that is hypohydrophily and epihydrophily. So what is the meaning of hypo? Hypo means below. So whenever the pollination which can take place below the water or underwater, so that type of pollination is categorized as an hypohydrophily. For example, the members of lily or the members of nymphaea. So they are the good examples which can show presence of hypohydrophily. The next one is the epihydrophily. Epi means above. Means those plants in which, even though they are aquatic one, but here the pollination can take place above the water. For example, Vallisneria. This is the good example which shows the presence of epihydrophily. So this hydrophily, it is going to categorize under two types, that is hypo means below water and epihydrophily means above the water pollination. So just see that there are some examples of hypohydrophily, like Narcissus, Lilium, Ceratophyllum. So all these members, they show presence of hypohydrophily. While if you observe this image, so see that they are the male and female flowers of Vallisneria. And see here, there is a traveling of male flowers towards that female flower above the water. That's why this type of pollination, we call it as an epihydrophily. Then see that what are the conditions which are required to carry out water pollination. So see that as the pollen grains, they are produced below water. So to avoid the decaying of pollen grain, they should have the waxy coating. Just like the wind pollination, in water pollination also there is a huge loss of pollen grains. That's why the pollen grain should be produced in numerous quantity. Then next one, here also there is no need to become the flower more attractive one, or they should produce a particular type of fragrance to attract different types of insects or birds, because it is the abiotic type of pollination. As well as here, there is no need to produce the nectar. So these are the conditions which are required to carry out the water pollination. Then next we are moving towards the biotic agencies. So under that one, the first one, that is the insect. So the pollination which takes place with the help of insects like moths, wasps, butterflies or beetles. So that we call it as an entomophily. So entomophily means it is nothing but the insect pollination. So just we see what are the different types of conditions which are required to carry out the insect pollination. So see that as this is the type of biotic agencies, that's why if you observe here, so flower, it should be bright in color. The flower should produce nectar. Okay. Basically, for the insect pollination, the flower, it should be large, it should be attractive, it should produce a particular type of fragrance. So just see here, The flowers are big, that's why insect can easily land on that flowers. Very easily they are able to collect the anthers, and at the time of collecting anthers, see here, collecting nectar, the anthers, they get attaches to the legs or to the backside of that insect, and when this insect they visit on another flower, the pollination can take place. So for the insect pollination, see that some of the flowers, they show presence of the pattern like that. The corolla, it should be like that. Then the flower, it should be a big one. Then it should be, the flower should be attractive one. It should produce particular type of fragrance, as well as the most important factor is that the flower should produce nectar. So all these conditions, they are required for the insect pollination. Then see that there are some examples of entomophilous flower like salvia. So the example, this is the example of salvia, which shows presence of insect pollination. Yucca, members of Moraceae, like different members of ficus, the members of orchid, tuberose, various members of Polygonaceae family. So all of them, they show presence of insect pollination. So moving towards next, the next type of pollination, that is the bird pollination. So the pollination which takes place with the help of bird like crow, sparrow, hummingbird, parrot or bulbil. So that we called it as an bird pollination, and that bird pollination, it is called as an ornithophily. So just see that what are the conditions to carry out the bird pollination. So if you observe here the shape of flower, so for the pollination with the help of birds, the flower should be tubular. That's why the beak of that bird, it can easily inserted into that flower, and whatever the anthers are there, they should stick on the beak of that bird. And when these birds, they are flying somewhere else, so they can drop the pollen grains on another flower. So in this way, the pollination can take place. So just observe here, the flowers, for the bird pollination also, the flower should be attractive. It should produce particular type of fragrance to attract the birds, as well as flower should have to produce the nectar. The most important thing is that the flower should be tubular in nature. That's why the birds can easily collect their nectar. And at the time of collecting nectar, there should be the pollen grains, they should be transferred on their beak, and the pollination can take place. So just see here that the conditions, the flower should be attractive and bright in color. The flower should produce nectar. The anthers are basically present towards the anterior side or inside the flower. That's why they can easily stick to the beaks or feathers of the birds. Then we see what are the examples of ornithophily. So see that the plant like bombax, the members of family Bixaceae, Erythrina, Butea, Thibetia, Calystemon, Gloriosa, Delonyx. So all these members, they are going to carry out the ornithophily, means the bird pollination. So the next member under the biotic agency, that is the bat. So bat, it is one of the most important pollinating agent. So the pollination with the help of bat, that we called it as chiropetrophily. Then we see what are the conditions which are required to carry out the chiropetrophily. So if you observe here the flowers, so there, as the bats can visit to the flower at night time, that's why there is no need to become the flower attractive, but the flowers have to produce a particular type of fragrance. That's why the bats can attract it towards that fragrance. They should produce, flower should produce the nectar. then the flower should be big. They are large one. That's why the bat can easily land on that flower to collect the nectar. Okay. So these are some of the important conditions to carry out the bat pollination. See that the flowers must be large. The flower need not to be become bright or attractive in color, but the flower should produce nectar. The flower should be fragrant one. Then see that there are some examples of the plant which can carry out the chiropetrophily, means the bat pollination, like Adansonia, Kygelia, Bahunia. Then along with this biotic agencies, there are some other type of biotic agencies like the snails, sludge, ants. They are also participate in the process of pollination and acts as an biotic agent of pollination. So under that one, the next type, that is the malacophily. So malacophily means whenever the pollination can takes place with the help of snails or sludge, so that we call it as an malacophily. Then the next type of see here, the members of family Cucurbitaceae, the members of Agaveaceae, or various members of Cirrhopagia, the member of Clematis. So in that one, the snail pollination can take place. The pollination with the help of snake can take place. So whenever the snake can travel through that plant, the pollen rays, they get attached to the skin of snails. Skin of snakes, and at the time of traveling, they get transfer the pollen rain from one plant or one flower to another flower. So in this way, the snakes are also participating in the process of pollination. Then next, myrmecophily. So it means whenever the pollination can takes place with the help of ants. So various members like acacia, anemone, jasmine, limonia, various members of Cucurbitaceae, Clematis, they show presence of pollination with the help of ants. So see that basically the ants are present on the plants which can produce the type of gum or some type of sticky substance or nectar. So see that here the ants also plays important role in the process of pollination. So for that one also, the flower should be large enough to enter the ants. They should produce nectar. They should produce particular type of fragrance. Okay. So these are some of the conditions which are required to carry out the ant pollination, as well as the plant should produce some sticky type of substances like gum, resin. So on that plant, the ants are present and the pollination can take place with the help of ants. So this is all about the agencies of pollination. So if you like this video, please like, share and subscribe my channel. Thank you.